Webinar will exceptionally last longer than 30 minutes, probably not 1 hour, but a bit longer, so you know. Today's webinar is about the Frankfurt Agreement and the principles and day-to-day management. And I have the pleasure to tell you that we have today three speakers. Before I do that, I would like to tell you, as usual, you're all muted, but you have the possibility to enter your questions in the Q&A panel of the GoToWebinar. We will not take your questions at the end of the webinar in a speaking form, but we will register your questions in any case, and we will come back to you with an answer in a written way. Also, it's maybe important for you to note that we will have a second webinar in November organized by the IEC, so the questions that you raise might help producing a successful webinar in November as well. So please go ahead, enter your questions, as many as you like, and we will come back to them after the webinar, not today. So if you are on social media, please feel free to tweet about the webinar. We have our hashtag 1010 webinar for that. And like I said, we have today three speakers for representing Sun and Sunelec. We have Catherine Vigneron, who is customer service specialist for energy and living standards. There is in the room here Geert Maas, who is Customer Solution Manager for Industry and Electrotechnology Standards. And then we have on the other side of the line, connected from Geneva, Mr. Gilles Tonnet, who is Head of Standardization Strategy and Secretary of the SMB, representing, of course, the IEC during this webinar. So please, all of you speakers, go ahead.
This is Gilles Tonnet speaking. Good morning to everyone and welcome to this webinar. In terms of the outline, we're going to review interesting facts about the Frankfurt Agreement, starting by reviewing the purpose and the objective of the agreement. We will give you a reminder of the value of IEC and Sunelec standards. We will then move to the four pillars of the Frankfurt Agreement, digging a little bit more into the details and the day-to-day management. We will cover as well the relation between the European standardization system and the EU legislation. And at the end, we will finish with a couple of practicalities, such as specific European elements like the Annex ZZ, or how to handle the comments of the HAS consultants. But just to start with, I just wanted to give you a very quick historical background. You, of course, know the Frankfurt Agreement, which was signed 3 years ago during the IEC General Meeting in Frankfurt. But actually, the Sunelec and IEC have enjoyed a very long and very close partnership. About 30 years collaboration, starting in 91 with the so-called Lugano Agreement, which was then reviewed in 96 with the Dresden Agreement. And today, we're going to review the Frankfurt Agreement, which is the last version of this partnership. This actually resulted in a very close alignment between Sunelec and IEC, with about 80% of Sunelec standards, which are aligned on IEC standards. That's why IEC is, of course, very important to Sunelec. And at the same time, Sunelec is really a key partner of IEC due to this alignment. So let's start by reviewing the main objective or the main purpose of the Frankfurt Agreement. The agreement itself, its purpose is really to recognize the primacy of international standards. There are, of course, some specifics at the European level, but if we want to really make a rational use of available resources on both sides, on the IC side and on the Sunelec side, and avoid duplication of work, we should aim at an alignment between Sunelec and IEC standard as close as possible. So the Frankfurt Agreement recognized this primacy of international standard and commit to primarily undertake the work at the IEC level. it also aims at accelerate the publication and the common adoption of those international standards in order to respond to market needs at the European level as well, but also worldwide. As I said, many of the IEC standards are adopted by Senelec as such or with minor deviations. In some cases, there are some specific requirements of European stakeholders. So the Frankfurt Agreement also includes some mechanism to look at those particular needs and handle possible deviations to IEC standards that may arise from those European stakeholders. But at the end of the day, the agreement itself aims really at supporting the European market using global standards to the largest extent as possible. Just a reminder about IEC standards. I guess you all know very well the IEC. The IEC is a global organization consisted of 173 countries, including members as well as affiliates from developing countries. The IEC covers roughly 99% of the world population and electricity generation. And we estimated that IEC deliverables directly impact about 20% of international trade, which is quite significant. The IEC is independent, neutral, inclusive, working according to the principle one country, one vote, which makes it a very trustful partner at the international level. Of course, IEC standards contribute to product safety and quality. They can decrease cost as well. They foster interoperable ecosystems, which is important today because of the convergence of technologies and the increasing use of IT content in many of our standards. IEC standards are also a technical source for laws and regulations across the world. And finally, they also commit to the technical barriers to trade agreement, which is developed and fostered by the World Trade Organizations.
Yes, thank you, Jill. And we can add to that that on top of this big value that IEC standards have and create, Senelec is not just taking over IEC standards, but we add extra value. Because of the particularities in Senelec, where we create one region, one standard, replacing 34 others by the obligation to implement on our members, the obligation to respect standstill, which means that our members cannot undertake any competing work, and last but not least, by conferring the status of European standard to IEC standards, which has a particular meaning in Europe, for instance, in the use for public procurement. Moreover, about 30% of the Senelec portfolio consists of harmonized standards. We will explain a little bit more what this exactly means later on. But in these harmonized standards are an important tool to demonstrate presumption of conformity with European legislation and the famous CE marking, as thus providing access to the European market of 600 million consumers using global standards. This is very important. It is often overlooked, but it is a real, real added value to the technical value provided by IEC standards, where we add a layer of product conformity and access to market.
Yeah, well, thanks, Geert, for this addition. We're going to now review the main pillars of the Frankfurt Agreement. So if you actually look at the agreement itself, you will notice there are four main pillars. The first one is the common planning of work, which covers both the work initiated at the IEC level or the work initiated at the Senelec level. The second pillar is the parallel voting on draft international standards. The third one is cover the publication requirements, which actually deals with the numbering of the publication, which is defined in the ISO IEC guide 21. And the fourth one is the conversion of European standards into IEC international standards. So in the next slide, we're going to cover those four pillars. I'm going to start with the common planning of work with the work initiated at the IEC level. So when there's a new work item proposed on the IEC side, the usual procedure on the CENELEC side is to assign this work to a mirroring CENELEC technical committee or reporting secretariat. It is registered in the CENELEC database with the appropriate timeline, of course. A feedback is usually given to the IEC with specific regional information. For instance, if there are some legislative aspects on the EU side that the IEC should be aware of. And then the parallel adoption process starts on the CENELEC side. In some cases, some IEC projects are what we call exempted, either permanently or temporarily from this parallel procedure. We will give you a little bit more detail later on about those exemptions, but in those cases, there's no European adoption as such, but the national adoption is still possible by CENELEC members. In that case, those standards or projects which are listed as exempted are called used as such in Europe. So there are no competing standards. But there will be a little bit more detail in the rest of the presentation about how to deal with those exemptions and or where they come from, what's the rationale, for instance, and why they don't follow the usual process.
Thank you, Gilles. Regarding the work initiated in CENELEC, in fact, before putting forward a proposal for a new work, including the revision of existing standards, the CENELEC Technical Committee has first to ensure that there is no overlapping IEC work which exists, and or also assess whether its corresponding IEC Technical Committee would initiate such a work timely to meet European needs. If there is none, the proposal for new work item is considered at the CENELEC Technical Board level. And on approval of this new work item for a European standard at CENELEC level, the default situation is that the new work item is offered to IEC. Indeed, CCMC informs the IEC CEO of the creation as soon as possible. And this does not prevent the CENELEC Technical Committee to start the work. On the IEC side, IEC starts a new work item process on the work item, and CCMC is informed on the outcome of the IEC vote. This lasts for 24 weeks. If IEC accepts the new work item, CENELEC hands over the work to IEC and the work continues at international level. For some specific reason, which is described in a technical board decision, the CENELEC technical board can decide not to offer the new work item to IEC, but we can make some additional explanation on this later on.
Maybe it is useful at this point in time to make a little remark, because there are very, very few of these cases where the new work item initiated in CENELEC is taken over by the IEC, for the very good reason that the first bullet applies. Before initiating any such proposal, there is a thorough assessment whether the IEC could already undertake the work. And if this is the case, usually the work is already initiated in IEC. So this is a little bit negative measurement of a very well functioning of how the national committees, the European national committees, address work in Senelec and IEC. Back to you, Catherine.
Thank you, Dirk. Let's now focus on the second aspect, the second pillar of the Frankfurt Agreement. It concerns the parallel voting. Regarding the parallel voting on draft international standards, IEC projects adopted in parallel, or I mean, following the parallel procedure in Senelec, follow the IEC rules and procedure. Parallel vote means that members, Senelec members, vote on the same text as the IEC members at the same time. It means following the same time frame. But let's go now into a little bit more details on the parallel procedure. At new work item stage, NP mentioned here, CCMC ensure the creation of the corresponding work item in the Senelec database. CCMC also ensure that those work items that are identified to become harmonized standards are marked as such in the database and inform the IEC central office. The Senelec Technical Committee has a very important role to play in this context. Indeed, as of the new work item is created, it is in the work program of the Senelec Technical Body, Technical Committee. Therefore, the Senelec Technical Committee body is invited to undertake from the earliest possible stage the necessary steps for the drafting and the availability of the European elements. The question is, yes, but what are those European elements? European elements are the so-called common modifications and or specific annexes, annex ZA, annex ZZ. We will come a little later on more description of this, but it is very important that they are available at inquiry and formal vote, or let's say at CDV and FDIS stage. Please note, and this is also very important, that Senelec Technical Body Secretariat is responsible to provide to CCMC all these European elements as soon as possible, and of course before the inquiry and the vote. Last but not least, it is also important to note that common modification will not be merged as in the past to the core text of the EN, but it will be an amendment 11 to the EN-IEC standard. This amendment 11 is the numbering, the reference of the European amendment to an IEC standard. This is for the theory. Let's now jump to some statistics. Very important statistics regarding the relation between IEC and Senelec. More than 75% of IEC standards follow parallel procedure in Senelec. 80% of IEC standards are therefore also European standards. This means that more than 80% of all European standards, whether they are mother standard, I mean, single standard or amendments, are identical or based to IEC standards. This is very important statistics. Now, continuing with figures, the question you might have is, yeah, but why don't we have 100% of parallel procedure? It's because there are still some European specificities, and the Senelec Technical Board can decide to exempt IEC projects which are considered outside the interest of Senelec members and are therefore not to be submitted to inquiry and vote within Senelec. Exemptions, which are as said decided by the Senelec Technical Board, can be permanent or temporarily. Items temporarily exempted from parallel procedure are either for, or I mean also those permanently exempted, are either for a specific version or for adoption after IEC publication. It is also to be noted that there are projects like database, standards referred to in international legislation, and so on, which are exempted as such in Europe. Now, regarding the third pillar of the Frankfurt Agreement, The ISO IEC Guide 2021 adoption of international standard is applied. Therefore, as from 2018, there is what we call the ENIC referencing, which is implemented. What does it mean? It means that standard, Senelec standard, identical to IEC publication are named ENIC 60-something. We still have some case where the main standards need to be directly adopt, need to be directly adopt as modified. And for those, the EN naming will be kept as EN 60 series. But this is very rare case. This is those standards which were already in the pipe. This should disappear in the future. And when there is no relation with the IEC publication, when it is a real homegrown standard, we call it EN 50 something. This is for the publication requirements. Regarding the conversion of European standards into international standards, all Senelec deliverables of European origin, what we call homegrown standards, which means those with an EN 50 series, are offered to IEC for possible conversion into an IEC standard. The ICCO submit this to the relevant technical board, the technical body, technical committee, for consideration and possible decision. CCMC is informed of any decision. Now, if an IEC technical body takes a European work on board, if the text is identical or the text work on or developed at IEC level is identical to the Senelec text, is the famous boomerang case. Then, when IEC will take over the development of the project, at European level, we will not go into parallel voting because it's the same text. And once IEC published, we will simply at European level publish a corrigendum to the EN. And the corrigendum will concern the numbering. If the IEC text is different from the Senelec text, then the Senelec technical body should advise CCMC on the adoption parallel, on the adoption procedure, which would be parallel vote in that case. But what is important for us to know is to know whether we would need common modifications or not. What I also need to mention is, in any case, when common modifications are necessary to achieve alignment to Senelec stakeholders' needs, for instance, adaptation to the European legislation and so on, the resulting common modifications are also systematically offered to IEC for possibly adapting at IEC level. So it does not mean that if you are preparing, let's say, technical development to adapt to the European legislation, which is of course purely European, we will still offer to IEC because there might be an interest at IEC level. This was for the four pillars of the Frankfurt Agreement, and I will now give the floor to Geert, who will explain us the relation between European standardization system and EU legislation.
Yes, thank you, Catherine, for this. So, the relation between the European standardization system and European legislation is often misunderstood and often underestimated, because also for IEC and for non-European IEC members, there is a big opportunity in understanding this system and trying to address certain requirements at international level already. So, first of all, we have the very particular relationship called the new approach or new legal framework, which is not so new because it dates back from 1986. But the basic principles still apply, no matter what may happen for the time being in this whole landscape where people get more meticulous or sometimes very frustrating. Deep legal requirements are asked, the principles remain. The legislation sets down goals and defines what needs to be reached at a relatively high level. I can give you the example of EMC legislation in Europe. It simply says you will not disturb too much and you will be sufficiently immune, and some other very basic things. So that is what are the goals the legislation wants to reach. Those requirements are compulsory. They are set out by the public authority, and they are only revised when policy requires so. So if you look again, for instance, at EMC or low voltage, these requirements have not changed, although we have new legislation. But if you look carefully, these requirements stay broadly the same. Now, a second level is then how to reach these goals. And then we come into the domain of harmonized standards, where CEN, CENELEC and ETSI, who are the recognized European standardization organizations, as private independent organizations, can define on a voluntary basis a way to reach, how to reach these goals by the use of standards. These standards are supposed to represent the state of the art and undergo the 5-year review cycle in CENELEC and ETSI. And of course, in this frame of the Frankfurt Agreement, 70 to 80% of the CENELEC standards are directly identical to or based on IEC standards. So you see the link between IEC standardization and European legislation and conformity to that. One of the effects here is that in Europe we have the so-called CE marking, where we can use harmonized standards as a cost-effective route to bring Europe, products to the European market. So there are figures that show that the costs to show conformity to the of the product to the market are more than 30% lower than using any other route. So there's a, through the 80% alignment of CENELEC to the IEC, there's a unique opportunity also for non-European stakeholders in the IEC by addressing certain essential requirements at IEC level to have identical standards and to use a global standard identical to benefit from the from this specific mechanism. Now, we have a lot of questions flying around on how do we get to these harmonized standards. They don't come themselves. So first of all, the European Commission needs to issue a standardization request to CEN and CENELEC, stating which standards they want, by when, and which essential requirements need to be covered, if there are other requirements that need to be covered. CEN and CENELEC then need to consider when they to accept or not the standardization requests, the ISO and IEC work programs, because we have the Vienna Agreement at CEN side. At CENELEC side, we have the Frankfurt Agreement, which we try to talk about here. And there is a big discussion ongoing on the format of these standardization requests. And of course, how we can reflect and connect the standardization request with the work program of CEN and CENELEC, in order to also connect to the IEC work program, if we talk about the Frankfurt Agreement, and within the frame of that work program, develop those harmonized standards the Commission requested. In order to have these standards and finally accepted as harmonized standards, we have some supplementary steps. So the so-called assessment by the HAS consultants. We will come to that later. They are the interface between standardization and the European Commission to give an insight in how the Commission could accept the standards as being harmonized. And finally, if the standards are found to be compliant, they can be accepted by the Commission as harmonized standard, and the reference can end up in the official journal of the European Union. So, the big word is out. Harmonized standards consultants, HAS consultants, who are they? What do they do? And what the hell do they do in standardization? Now, they are the practical interface, in fact, between the Commission and the standardizers world. They need to report back to the Commission and to the standardizers if the standards meet certain criteria. So HAS consultants are independent experts. They have been selected because they have a certain expertise in standardization and in the field of work they have to assess. They are contracted by the Commission, so they are not Commission functionaries, but they are contracted by the Commission through a general contractor, which in this case is Ernst & Young, for a period of still, let's say, until the end of 2021, 2022, something like that. And they have two main tasks. Their task is to assess the documents drafted by the European standardization organizations, and in the Frankfurt Agreement, by extent, the part supplied by IEC, we will come to the process, and they have to communicate with the technical bodies to try to contribute to the compliance of the drafted documents with the Commission's standardization requests. It is very, very, very important to note that the HAS consultants are no comments they have are no veto on the consensus building. They're an input for compliance to EU legislation. And therefore, when these, and Gilles will explain later on how we can convey these comments to the IEC level, the ICTC might decide to pick up the comments or not. But by picking it up, we can help fulfilling the goal to maximize the number of harmonized EN-IEC standards without common modes. Of course, this has to be framed in a global view. So we have to sometimes recognize that the requirements by the European legislator are different than or more stringent or deviating from international markets. We can regret this, but we have to deal with this. As standardizers, we have to choose whether we then want harmonized standards identical to global or not. And if we disagree with legislation, we have fora in Europe where together with industry partners, we can try to influence the interpretation of that. But it is not by the standard itself. That are other processes. Now, how does this all interact with the Frankfurt Agreement and the development of standards? It is very simple, yet very complicated. You see here the parallel process, where you see that in the IEC, a standard is drafted, and the different moments where in Senelec we could have exchanges. For instance, in the first drafting stage, completely to the left, the Senelec TC should look into how develop certain European elements, such as the link to the essential requirements. Consider if what we know from the IEC work will fit European purpose, or do we need changes? Do they need to end up in common modes, or can the Senelec TC convey these comments as soon as possible to IEC in order to promote their uptake into the international standard using all means available in terms of annexes or regional differences, to have as much as possible an identical IEC and CENELEC standard. A first stage there is CD, and there already you see that the European technical body can ask the consultants for a view on the committee draft, the text that is drafted in the IEC and which is available at the, should be circulated at the CENELEC TC level in order to generate these comments and these insights. Next phase is that then the CD goes to CDV at and is submitted to the IECCO for that. And at the same time, CENELEC starts the preparation of the parallel inquiry on the CDV, where we submit the texts from CENELEC, completed with the texts from the IEC to the consultants for an assessment. These results can then come back in the inquiry and are addressed during the further stages where we take the comments after CDV. And then we have a third moment when the documents go from back to IEC CO to start the preparation of the FDIS. At the same time, in CENELEC, we start preparing the parallel formal vote. And we send again all the results from the CENELEC work plus the new IEC text to the consultants for assessment. All this at the side of the commission is tied together by Ernst & Young in as the HAS contractor. So there is this continuous the consultants feedback to the HAS contractor, who has an obligation to feedback to the HAS, to the desk officer. And hopefully the result is then compliant. And when at the publication stage, all is this found compliant, then we can end up in the official journal. Total time frame for the development and the publication is in principle dependent on the IEC timeframe, where without any hurdles, CENELEC should be in phase. Once the documents are made available or published, let's say it like that, the next quarter, if they're compliant, we can offer them to the Commission. And if all goes well, within 3 or 4 months, we should see a citation in the official journal. In practice, last 2 years, this has to be shown a very tedious process, because also at commission side, there has been a thorough review of their processes to do so. And we slowly see things getting back into motion, but not as quickly as industry or other stakeholders, and certainly CENELEC and IEC would wish. So, this was quite some explanation, I think. How does this now in practice link to certain aspects of the work, Catherine?
Yeah, so we had an overview of the theory. So let's see in practice how it works. So we will focus on the following aspects: monitoring of work program, European elements, more info on Annex, on the famous Annex ZZ, a few words by Geert on the normative references, and Gilles will explain us how the HAS consultant comments are transferred to at IEC level. Regarding the first aspect, the monitoring of the technical committee work program, bearing in mind the important target of 80% alignment between IEC and CENELEC standard, we require the CENELEC technical committee to closely monitor their work program. Their work program, I mean the CENELEC committee, technical committee work programs are always available on the CENELEC website, but also through our database, which has an interface available for our TC, technical committee secretary, which is called Projects Online. On the other hand, we also invite our technical committee, as the CENELEC technical committee, to closely monitor also the IEC work program in order to timely comment a draft, in order to avoid as much as possible and as much as feasible common modifications. Other important aspects for European technical committees are also to make the link as soon as possible with the relevant European pieces of legislation. Is this draft progress into an harmonized standard or not, etc., etc. The key message is it is crucial to ensure that work items reflect all aspects, on one hand at CENELEC level, but also at IC level. Now, regarding these famous European elements, the first question is, yeah, but what are those European elements? European elements are parts of the standards, like common modifications, so really specific technical aspects which needs to be in for the European standards. And in that context, the timing is key. We, CCMC, so the CENELEC Management Center, needs to get those elements at hand as soon as possible. And as said before, these elements, these new common modifications, will be also offered to IEC for any possible later uptake. Another European element, or what we call European elements, is the Annex ZA. The Annex ZA is the correspondence, it's a page of a standard, of a European standard, is the correspondence between the IEC normative references and the European normative reference. We ask our technical committees to provide this Annex ZA as well as soon as possible. And for harmonized standards, it's also key, crucial, to send to CCMC this famous Annex ZZ. And I'll come on the definition of this famous Annex ZZ in my next slides. That was for European elements which will be part of the European standard. But technical committees, CENELEC technical committee, are also invited, especially in case of harmonized standards, to send to the CENELEC Management Center any relevant information that may be of any help or use by the new approach consultant, the HAS consultant, so that, I mean, any element that would help him to make his assessment positive, of course. It can be a risk assessment, it can be the justification for the use of undated normative reference, it can be specific sectorial arrangement if you deem necessary to send us documents which would ease the assessment of your document. To get a positive one, please send it to us and we will send it to the HAS consultant in the stage explained, in the stage during the process as explained by here in the slide before. I will now give a little bit more information on this famous Annex ZZ. So it is an informative annex, so it's composed of a standardized introduction and a table. This table indicates the relationship between the essential requirement or safety objective of the European regulation or directive aimed to be covered and the applicable clauses of the standard. You can have in one European standard as many Annex ZZ as EU regulation directive the standard aimed to cover, to support, sorry.
We say it's here, it remains as many Annex ZZ, because I have a version of the presentation where we have this also Annex ZA. This might be some confusion, because in CEN and ISO, this Annex ZZ is called Annex ZA. So that is to keep people awake. Thank you. Sorry, Carol.
I was awake this morning. I changed it. So yes, as many annexed ZZ as EU regulation directive aim to support, to be supported by the standard. For this annexed ZZ, we do have some templates which are available on the CENELEC website. And it's a three-column table. In the first column, you have the essential requirements safety objective of the EU pieces of legislation. In the second column, you have to put the clauses of the standards. And in the third column, you can add some remarks. The required level of granularity is, of course, essential and it's very important. And the level of granularity is the essential requirements or safety objectives of the directive to be supported. Several essential requirements can be taken together if covered by the same clause. For instance, essential requirements 2 or 3 of this directive is covered by clause 3 of clause 4. But of course, it can be expanded in more lines if the requirements are not covered in the same clauses. So essential requirements 2 covered by clause 3, essential requirements 4 covered by clause, 5. But of course, what is also important to notice is that not all clauses of a standard are clauses containing technical requirements to be followed. We do have some definitions in the standards, we have some references, some scopes. It is therefore very, very, very challenging to have an all clause statement in a standard. It is less challenging, and I would say it's the best case scenario, is to indicate it, all the clauses covered very clear in a table. You also need to put yourself in the shoes of the reader, that things need to be very clear. So that was some info on the basic info on the Annex ZZ. Now the next question is, do I need to have an Annex ZZ if my standard is in part, and so on. So in case of standards with parts, we have different case scenario. We have scenario standards with a part one with requirements applicable to all products and other parts with requirements for different type or intended use of product. We have parts all mutually independent, or one part dealing with limits or test level and another part dealing with measurement methods and a third part dealing with performance criteria. Do I need one Annex ZZ or do I need a separate Annex ZZ for each part? The answer is relatively simple. Parts that do not confer presumption of conformity, so POC in the slide is presumption of conformity, standalone document, then there's no need to list it. Then if there is no need to list it in the official journal, there's no need to have an Annex ZZ. In fact, there is a need to have an Annex ZZ for each part that needs to be listed in the official journal of the European Union. And then another question we have sometimes is, but do I need to have an Annex ZZ for my amendment if I want my amendment to be published in the official journal? Then it's a case by case, it depends. When amending the standards, when drafting this amendment, it is up to the TC to consider whether this amendment needs to be needs to have a specific Annex ZZ or not. Of course, the whole philosophy behind is that if you amend clauses which are giving presumption of conformity, there's a big chance that you need to amend also your Annex ZZ, or at least that the TC needs to carefully think and consider this. So a real consideration by the TC is required in that case. And now I will give the floor for the hot potato of the day to here, the normative reference.
Hot potato, you say? Indeed, yeah. Indeed. So I will make myself the most popular guy in the room or in the web conference here, with some confronting statements. To make normative reference in standards is one, the normative reference in standards are one of the main sources for non-compliance and where the Commission refuses to accept standards as harmonized standards. And why is that? That is because we simply don't follow our own rules. Because there is an agreement with the Commission that the IEC directives part 2 and the CENELEC internal regulations part 3, which are quasi identical except for some small additions, are more than sufficient to justify the, and if we follow that, to have the references accepted. And contrary to popular belief, undated references are not the default solution for normative referencing. The default solution is in article in clause 10.5 of the directives and internal regulations on dated references. Because if you cannot meet certain conditions for undated references, you have to date. Which means there is no condition to date, but there is a condition to use undated references. So dated references are somewhere the default solution. Which also means that when the reference document is amended or revised, the TC needs to review the dated references and assess whether they should be updated or not. Another important thing to notice, there's a common misunderstanding on that, is that the normative dating happens within the text of the standard, not in clause 2 of the standard, normative references, which is an informative part and who is merely repeating the dating in the referencing in the standard. Now, undated references are also very well described, and we can use them under certain conditions, which we need to assess. So, only when we refer to a complete document, and when it will be possible to use all future changes of the referenced document for the purposes of the referring document. So, this is in red, because this is the big challenge. And the reference will include all amendments to and revisions of the reference document. Now, it is easy to say this. You have to assess it for all, and especially for the purposes of the referring document. And there is the big difference and difficulty, because IEC and CENELEC finally operate in a different context. So it is very well possible that the same analysis at IEC and at CENELEC level lead to different outcomes and conclusions. In IEC, the conclusion may be, okay, we disregard the fact that another partner organization uses this in a certain legal context, and for us, the outcome of the analysis is that we can use undated reference. However, at CENELEC level, if the standard is harmonized, the outcome might be, this is not so stable, or we need to date. And it requires quite some analysis to see whether we need to date or not. And I can explain why, because if you go to the next slide, we have a legal requirement which is expressed in the European Commission requirements and position on this. Commission standards, although they respect that they are voluntary documents from private organizations, form part of a legal system where the presumption of conformity is a legal effect of the standard that is given by the European Commission. So you can use the standard in a particular way, and it is the legislator that allows this use, this voluntary use. But in this legal action by the Commission, so there's no legal action by CENELEC, there's no legal action by the IEC, in this legal action by the Commission, the Commission say they need a certain certainty as to the extent and the scope of this legal effect. So they need to be sure that we don't alter the effect of presumption of conformity, and the dating and the beginning and the ending of this legal effect. It's a little bit of a difficult explanation sometimes, but it boils down to the fact that in European context for normative references, we need limited and controlled reference chains. Sometimes when you start analyzing a document, you refer to a reference that refers to another reference, and we have multiple cases where we refer back to the first document. Of course, this in the end could pose a problem. A common misunderstanding is that normative references really do not need to be harmonized standards. So you can say, I need performance X based on the test in standard Y, and standard Y doesn't need to be a harmonized standard. Okay? However, you can ask yourself the question again, does this reference to standard Y need to be dated or undated, depending on the context? On top of that, the Commission requests that documents used as normative reference must be publicly available. Again, if you follow IEC directives and CELNIC internal regulations, to the allowable documents, there is no problem. Normally, it's okay. There is a preference to have a reference to the latest edition of standards when using dated normative references. However, and there are multiple examples of that, it is acceptable to refer to older versions because sometimes it's the older version that is suitable and not the new one. And then again, we come to the most hot potato is to evaluate the suitability of each normative reference and the dating or undating. If we use undated reference, we have to evaluate the impact of the evolution of the standard that we refer to. For instance, for products covered, there is the risk of loss of conformity with a harmonized standard. What does this mean? The new version of the standard may imply stricter conditions, which means that, for instance, in terms of safety, yes, the product should be more safe. However, by doing this, a private organization would exclude certain economic actors that benefit from the presumption of conformity from this presumption of conformity by making the standard evolve. And that, in principle, should be an action done by the legislator. So by narrowing or making down the scope or making the standard more stringent, some economic operators that benefit from the presumption of conformity could lose this benefit, which is the right from the legislator to do, and therefore they refuse to let this happen through standardization. Although, technically speaking, this may be fully justified. On the other hand, for the standard, by using certain references undated, the standard may risk losing presumption of conformity because the standard we refer to may loosen requirements, thus not fulfilling the legal requirements in Europe anymore. Again, technically, this could be fully justifiable. However, to have this effect, that is a legal decision which is not in the hands of voluntary organizations. Therefore, this whole discussion on the evaluation of normative references. I hope I didn't lose you halfway. If that is the case, please shoot. We have also in CELNIC level an exercise ongoing for pilot cases where we try to work with TCs in this evaluation and see what the best practices are. It is a tedious job. We realize it's not simple. So if you have any questions, please don't hesitate. Pose them, and we will certainly come back to you. Now, Gilles, all this is to talk about harmonized standards. And there is an important aspect to that that you still need to highlight here.
Yes, thanks, Geert. I'm going to wrap up this practicality section by saying a few words about how the comments from the HAS consultants can be handled on the IEC side. Geert explained earlier the role of those HAS consultants as interfaces between the European Commission and the standardization world. They provide input for compliance to the EU legislation on harmonized standards. So they come up with a number of comments. Those comments can of course be taken into account by the IEC technical committees. It's up to them to decide. They have no obligation, of course, because it's not part of the formal commenting process of the IEC. But at the same time, it is an opportunity as well for those IEC committees to have input and feedback from a third party. So how to channel those comments to the technical committee? Well, the national committee, which is actually holding the secretariat of the CENELEC technical body or reporting secretariat, can convey actually two types of comment. The first one is using the formal IEC procedure. They will channel their own national committee comments as a national position. And the second one will be a separate set of comments, which include the comments coming from the HAS consultant. So you will see on the slide here that we label those comments XXX for the very simple reason that the IEC Central Office and the CCMC are still discussing actually how to label exactly those comments so that there's no misunderstanding. But the goal here is to have those two different channels, one which is the more formal channel coming from the National Committee, and the other one, with the help and the support of the National Committee holding the secretariat of the CENELEC technical body, to really provide those HAS consultant comments for consideration into the IEC technical committee. So I believe Geert or Catherine, you will summarize the takeaways of the presentation, because I guess we're coming
to the end. To add one word, indeed, if these XXX comments are still there as XXX, it's not because IECCO and CCMC disagree on the principle, but we want to find an acronym, a name, whatever, that will not raise any confusion about the nature of these comments. So therefore, it's a little bit difficult to find the right acronym, but I believe we will soon land on that, and you will present something at the next occasion of the SMB, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, no, that's a good comment, Geert. And as you said clearly, we want to avoid any misunderstanding, especially from non-European countries who could see this as a very weird element, or we just want to make sure, you know, everyone understands clearly the purpose of those comments. So that's why we're still discussing the best way of labeling them. If any of you have any great suggestion, of course, we'll be happy to hear them.
Thank you, Jim. Indeed. Now, what did we learn today? Or what do we think you should have learned today? First of all, CENELEC and the IEC have a long-standing partnership, which results in 80% alignment back and forth. This long-standing, we identified 30 years, but I think there's the background, it goes much deeper and goes to the very origins of the IEC and CENELEC. Secondly, CENELEC is more than just moving paper and adopting IEC standards. We add a lot of value by having one single standard for the European market and by having this interaction with European legislation. A message to all working in IEC and in CENELEC. And often people are personally making the bridge between the two levels, which is a very tedious job. We all appreciate that. It is very important to closely and timely mirror work at both sides in order to maximize identical adoption, because in the end, that is what we want. Wherever possible, use IEC standards first. Then, for those that did not know yet or did not realize it fully, harmonized standards, the special breed of European standards, are a cost-effective way to the EU market. And again, using global standards should be the goal. So also for the non-European national committees, this is an opportunity to access and bring their products to the European market without excessive costs and using the same kind of standards. Harmonized standards, again, this was the last slide. We have two particular points of attention here. It's the uptake of these triple X comments, which are comments related to the legislative context. And of course, this particular thing, that is the Senelec Annex ZZ, which tries to make a link between the essential requirements offered by the standard and in which clauses they are particularly addressed. So again,